Summer Scene, today from Happy Valley Goose Bay, with host Michael Coyne.
Tired for everything, but we cope with it.
Was that because your father was such a survivor, and I guess your mother as well?
Yeah, both of them, I think, really. We had 13 children, Mike. I'm the 12th, but I grew up as the youngest. And it was a matter of, yes, you worked if you wanted to survive. And we all had chores. Everybody worked.
Jean Crane was born in Northwest River in 1929. Her mother, Annie McLean, was from Kenemish, near Northwest River. Her father, Bert Blake, was originally a trapper from Doublemere, near Rigolette. In the 1940s, while living in Northwest River, her family gave up fishing and worked on the American base in Goose Bay. And in 1943, her family moved to Happy Valley. Jean continued at school in Northwest River.
I have memories of being across the river, though, on the north side, going to school in the... I guess you'd call it the dorm, we just called it Wood Cottage, was where I spent most of my years going to school, boarding, looking across the river at my house, and couldn't go home till Christmas and Easter. Had great thoughts about that, but it didn't get the better of me. I still had a happy childhood.
So you lived on one side of the river, went to school on the other side.
I lived equally on both sides, yes.
On both sides.
Yes.
You used to row back and forth across that water at the time with the fairly fast current. Did you find that hard? And as a young girl, you did it.
I started rowing about 8 years old, and by the time I was 10, I was full-fledged milk carrier, milkmaid. Mm-hmm. I took my little rowboat and rowed across to the mission hospital and picked up a quart of milk daily and rowed it back to our side of the river. That was one of my chores.
You kept busy.
Yes, it was a little hard rowing, but I didn't think of it as terribly hard. We grew up working hard and just expecting that to be part of our life, I guess. I was never alone. There were a lot of people around me. Indians were around me, and if I had a problem, I'd get in a canoe with them and go across and fetch my milk, come back.
Would you say you had your father and your whole family was self-sufficient? You lived a fairly good life.
Yes, I think we did. Yes, indeed. And we lived off the land and the sea and worked hard for everything, but we coped with it.
Was that because your father was such a survivor, and I guess your mother as well?
Yeah, both of them, I think, really. We had 13 children, Mike. I'm the 12th, but I grew up as the youngest. And it was a matter of, yes, you worked if you wanted to survive. And we all had chores. Everybody worked. Yes.
What about the summers you went to Indian Harbor where your father worked? Did you like the change?
Oh, yes. I was one of the big pushers that we should go. My father had been going to Indian Harbor to work at the hospital, and by then the hospital phased out, and it was in a shape that it could be torn down. So he made arrangements and tore down the hospital, took my brothers with him, and built us a summer house. And then after that, my mother could go with my sister and I. Before that, we always stayed home when the men were away. And you miss something when your family is all apart so many times of the year. So we wanted to go, and we wanted... Indian Harbor was about like going from here to St. John's or something. It seemed to be so far
mm-hmm.
away.
Yeah.
We talked our father into taking the whole family. My mother never liked being on the water in the boat. But she went, and I enjoyed being on the boat. I would be out with my brothers fishing, jigging for cod, and help them to clean the fish. I learned how to be a cutthroat. Do you know the differences in curing your fish? We salt cured and dried.
Mm-hmm.
I took part in everything that my brothers took part in. I was happier out in the boat than in the house. My sister helped my mother to do the cooking and cleaning, and I was glad to escape that.
You'd rather fish.
I would. I still would.
Yeah.
Yes.
Did you do much trapping with your father? I mean, he was known for his trapping.
No. Right? No, the most I ever did was caught a few rabbits right around home where I could walk out for half an hour from home. A few partridge hunts for overnight or something. I didn't trap with my father. By the time I was big enough, he was phasing out of trapping and beginning to work on base.
I see. Yeah. So you were still going to school?
I was still in school, yes.
Mm-hmm. And you, then again, you were away from your family again?
Yes, I had to still stay at the dorm in Northwest River to go to school. And they began to live in Happy Valley about 1943, or the next year. They were building the house. I came home to the valley for holidays, Christmas, Easter, summer holidays, working on base in the summer at the hotel.
I understand that you, at one point, you really felt like going home, or actually going
yes.
to find your family.
Yes. Well, my family, that's the first year that they lived in the valley. I was taking grade 10. And art was one of my most pleasant subjects. I thought it was great. I was no great shakes at it, but it was one of the good ones. I was writing my art exam, and it was the last one. When I heard the motorboat coming into the wharf in front of the school. And I glanced around, looked through the window, and knew the boat. It was Saunders' boat from the valley.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew that I could get home on it next day when they'd go. Well, that exam was written so fast, Mike, that I passed the art barely by the skin of my teeth. I was more interested in going home.
Yeah.
You know?
Your feelings for your family overcame the feelings for the art at the time.
Yes, and home was always like freedom, because you take a whole year in school. You know, we did 10 months them times.
Yeah. When you went to school, there was an interesting way in which your father paid for your education.
Yes, he was a woodcutter. The mission burnt all wood in all the buildings. That was before oil. And many of the trappers cut firewood by the turn, we call it. That's one length.
Yeah.
And they would go up to the mouth of Churchill River, it was called Grand River then, and cut perhaps several thousand turns of wood. Maybe there was a dozen men. And then the mission left it there till summertime, and in the open water they boomed it home with motorboats.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the last year I went to school, my fee was paid for my board, by my father and brothers cutting 1,000 turns of wood. I have the receipt for that yet. So that's different youth, I guess, also.
How do you put a price on that?
You don't. You don't. It was priceless. Yeah.
And how often did they do this?
Well, they did that every year, you know, the mission and our homes. We had wood ahead for a year and sometimes 2 years. It was all stuck up like teepees to dry.
Yeah.
And then, of course, the mission had a sawmill for lumber, and they had engines to saw it up, and the boys in school helped to load it into the woodshed. We had a horse and cart,
yeah.
And they loaded and unloaded all the mission wood. School kids helped.
So everybody had a hand in it?
Everybody had a hand in it, yes. I remember bringing in wood so many times, and three neighbor boys used to come to visit, and we'd save our carrying wood chores till they came to play. Smart?
Yeah. You have an interesting story about a finger. That
my youth is all in that finger.
And it has something to do with a trolley track that we used to go out on the wharf in Northwest River.
Yes, the track was there with a trolley to unload boats for the mission-like supplies. And we kids would sit on it and push ourselves back and forth. But this day I was climbing up on the wharf and head by hand like that, and somebody pushed it too quickly and broke my little finger. It went over the finger. I was 6 years old.
Yes.
And I ran to my host mother, crying, of course, and told her it was broke, and she kissed it, and she said, it will be all right tomorrow. So that never reached the doctor, although we had a good doctor in town, in the next building, really. Today people tell me it can be straightened, but I wouldn't straighten that for all the money in the world, no.
It holds too many memories.
Too many memories. It's not painful.
Was it painful at the time?
Oh, yes, I wasn't just crying my head off for attention.
You have an interesting, I think, history going back on both sides of your family. Like your grandfather on both sides, your grandfathers, have been around for a long time in Labrador.
Oh, yes. They were pioneers. My grandfather McLean came from Scotland, and that's my mother's side, of course. And he worked with the Hudson Bay Company as a clerk, and then he saw opportunities when the lumber companies that were in Mud Lake and Kennemish were pulling out, because they were here for just a few years. But they lumbered with horses. And in Mud Lake, there was a bridge where horses could pull logs across on carts and things. Well, when they were phasing out, he bought horses and settled into Kennemish and made a home of his own, homesteaded and had sheep. I remember my mother said she learned to spin and weave the yarn, and they grew gardens and they salmon fished right there from Kennemish, and his sons grew up with a good family farm. They were self-sustaining, yes.
Going back to the days when you were in boarding school or in school, staying away from your family, what did you do there other than the time that you're in school?
Well, we had chores that, you know, when you get up in the morning and did made your bed and helped with dishes or whatever and ran off to school, came home, dinner hour was short, half an hour to play. After schools, we had about an hour to play. On Mondays, we helped with the wash. Saturdays, we helped scrubbing. The floors were literally scrubbed with brushes. And from 6 years old, you learn how to do, even if it was just the hall or the stairs. You did chores constantly, all the time, which meant we only had an hour or two of play a day. And a lot of that, I look back now and I know, we spent a lot of that learning to knit and sew. And in our school, we had the boys had manual training, carpenter classes and woodwork things. The girls learned how to cook and sew in classes. So it was part of our life. And if you grow up like that, Mike, you always have knitting around, you always have sewing around. Imagine this now, the Second World War came on. We girls, teenagers, joined the ladies' auxiliary knitting socks and scarves for the overseas military people. And we were doing something all the time. We had girl guides and...
Did you ever get any replies?
Yes, we wrote little notes and put them in the socks, yes. We did have letters back from soldiers overseas. And, of course, we had a few local soldiers like Lee White and Saul Seabird, who is in that picture with the woodcutters. And Saul died in that war. We used to send them to pack on his little interesting story, should I tell you?
Sure.
We'd pack cigarettes and things to send them, or roll your own tobacco,
yeah,
things.
Yeah.
Now, when we packed the cigarettes, Lee wrote back and told us that he was very pleased to get tobacco because he was in Manila. And some of the tobacco is rolled with dung, some sort of horse dung or something. And he said the quality was poorly, and it was so good to get good tobacco. But he said they were always battered up. Everything was broken up from handling. And so after that, we put in extra packages of cigarette paper so he could re-roll your own.
Yes, yeah. I can imagine they were quite happy when they received it.
Yeah, we catered to things like that. We had a ladies' auxiliary that was connected with the war, boy.
Yeah.
You know, things like that.
Yeah. So what did you do then after you finished school?
After I finished school, I was working at Goose Bay in the hotel, Goose Airport, for about a year. And after that, I guess that's around time I met up with John, and the story has continued to today.
Yeah.
Yes.
You have children of your own, of course.
We have, yeah, we've raised six. They're all married around us here. 14 grandchildren, so still we're in the center of a big family yet.
Yes.
Yeah.
And lots of years left.
I hope so. Yes, indeed.
These days, it's her sketches and paintings that keep Jean Crane as busy as ever. Much of her work has been displayed at expositions in the province, and many of her paintings have been sold privately to people in Canada, the United States, and abroad. Although she didn't paint as a young girl, Jean Crane displayed her artistic talents through knitting and making practical things. It's only been in recent years that she's been doing what she didn't have time to do before.
We're doing a lot more things now that we couldn't do when our kids were young, and now we have time. John's retired, and we have time to do things we want to do. He paints as well as I do.
Yes. Mm. You mentioned the knitting, crocheting, and all the things that you did with your hands as a child growing up. Did you carry this over into your painting? You didn't start drawing and painting until a few years ago.
No, it was not many years ago, about seven now, I guess. I think, you know, we had artistic capabilities, and we were embroidering and making our own designs and things like that. We made our own patterns for clothing, or we just looked at a person and cut out a garment and sewed it up and it fit, or you adjusted till it fit. And, yeah, I think that we had a lot of the artistic capabilities and didn't use them in the sense that we are now painting.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the same thing, but you're doing it with paint.
Did you have any desire to paint when you were younger?
No, I watched a painter who came to Northwest River in my early years, Steve Hamilton from the States, spent a winter there, and I saw him paint a few times, and indeed he came to our school, and we dabbled in water paints about twice in my lifetime. And that was my total exposure to an artist's life, but I always thought about that. Not with any great desire or plans.
But today is a big part of your life.
Yes, I wish I had more hours in the day that I could spend with it, but I don't plan to let it take all my time from my family. I now have more time for my family than I used to have for them, and I still make time for them. Like, apart from that, paint almost all the time. John paints with me, makes it, you know, much more interesting.
Your paintings are a reflection of, I guess, the life that you live, because you do a lot of landscapes, and a lot of history and tradition are etched there.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think mostly about camping and log cabins and things like that. To me, you know, those are the greatest places in the world to be, camped out. That's my greatest enjoyment in life, I think, camping out.
Is that right?
And yes, fishing or berry picking. So those are things that my paintings revolve around, yes. Mm-hmm. Beautiful memories, really, because Northwest River, as you know, is so beautiful, summer or winter. I have memories of being across the river, though, on the north side, going to school in the, I guess you'd call it the dorm, we just called it Wood Cottage, was where I spent most of my years going to school, boarding, looking across the river at my house, and couldn't go home till Christmas and Easter. Had great thoughts about that, but it didn't get the better of me. I still had a happy childhood. And we lived off the land and the sea and worked hard for everything, but we coped with it. My father's sole life till he died was survival. It was food first and wood and keeping warm second. Everything else came after that. Mm-hmm. I took part in everything that my brothers took part in. I was happier out in the boat than in the house. My sister helped my mother to do the cooking and cleaning, and I was glad to escape that.
You'd rather fish.
I would. I still would.
Yeah.